My introduction to that tradition came in June of 1964 when I completed my junior year at Harvard College. I'd grown up in Bakersfield, California, where my father was a rabbi and my mother a teacher, and came to school here on a scholarship. But here is where I got involved with people working for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and civil rights work, and volunteered for the Mississippi Summer Project, which was an effort to support the organizing of African-American organizers in that state who were facing jailing, beating, and worse, just for trying to organize people to register to vote. My father had served as a chaplain in the American Army, so we had lived in Germany for 3 years after the Second World War, where a lot of his work, most of his work, was with Holocaust survivors. So as a child, I met people whose lives had been shattered by that horror. But my parents interpreted the Holocaust to me as not being simply about anti-Semitism, but about racism, and racism kills. You turn people into objects and anything can happen. And the civil rights movement was challenging the institutionalized racism that's been foundational to this country since its founding. Now, as a rabbi's kid, I don't know if there's any preacher's kids in the audience or here. Oh, there's one right there. What kind?
Episcopal.
All right. That's pretty good. Yeah, good. I'm sure you'll appreciate what you have to go to all the stuff. You know, you have to show up at it. You're also supposed to be perfect, which is sort of a different set of issues I'm not going to go into tonight. But I did love the Passover Seder. The story, the telling of the Exodus story with food, which was kind of cool. But there's a place where they would focus on the children and say, you were slaves in Egypt. And I said, what? I've never been a slave, never been to Egypt. It took me a while to figure out what it meant was that that story was not the property of one people, one time, one place. It's told generation after generation. And you have to sort of ask yourself, are you with those guys with the chariots and the horses? Or are you with those people trying to find a way to a land of promise for themselves? Civil rights movement spoke that, told that same story. Dr. King talked of the civil rights movement in terms of yet another chapter in the telling of the Exodus story. And it was a movement of young people. Dr. King, when he led the bus boycott in Montgomery, Alabama, was 25. And it makes sense. Walter Brueggemann, a Protestant theologian, wrote a book called The Prophetic Imagination, in which he talks about the fact that transformational vision or prophetic vision occurs at the intersection of two elements. One he calls criticality, which is a clear view of the world's hurt, of its need, of its pain, coupled, he says, with hope, a sense of its promise and its possibility. One without the other is despair or irrelevance. Together, they create the capacity for transformation. And young people come of age with a critical eye on the world they find, and almost of necessity, hopeful hearts. So for my generation, the civil rights movement was an invitation to enact that kind of vision or that kind of aspiration for change and transformation. Now, with all due respect to Harvard, my education about race, power, and politics began in Mississippi. Not in Cambridge.